Ah, I gotta get my board. Welcome. And here it is. Ready for tonight's exciting adventure once again in Philemon number 103. We are moving along. So I hope that you are ready to take in some interesting things. There's Leonard. Salutations, greetings, welcome, and good evening to you as well. Oh, I need to, I forget to post these things. There you go. All these extra duties that I have on top of the fact that I'm supposed to have my act together here with this exegetical stuff. Anyway, guess what? The routine continues. Does that come as any surprise? Yeah, all right. We got Leonard says ready to go as well. Yeah, I had just, I was going to highlight some of this stuff about the board here. I want to mention that we're going, this is pretty cool. We're going to be all over the Bible. And it's quite interesting because, you know, we're in Philemon, and that's how it works. Exegetically speaking, we have to do the due diligence, which includes all kinds of stuff as we are learning in our exegetical here, that I, principles and practice of Greek exegesis. I spent a couple of hours today, 2 hours to be exact, with a group of people on one of those meetings, whatever you call them, go-to meeting deals. And it was really interesting because the speaker was none other than the Dan Wallace. Now, I think I can show you, and I'll do it the easy way by grabbing my phone. Let me see if I got screenshots of Dan. Not exactly. What I can do is, you'll see him a little bit. Let me blow him up. Yeah, I can do it like that. All right, so here you go. See, Dr. Dan Wallace. And Dan was doing this kind of stuff. See, look, there is a Greek manuscript. And we were talking about external and internal evidence, choosing the reading that best explains the rise of the other. And the role of Tertius. And you can see here the meaning of, look here, as you read, of echomen. This one with an omicron, an O, that's eta, ki, omicron. Whereas when you look at this one over here, it's, I'm sorry, not eta, epsilon. Epsilon key omega. It's the only difference on those two. See, and look on the bottom. Only the one with the omicron gives Paul's real meaning. So, there are scriptures and in the background there. And people don't mess with this stuff. People don't know anything about this stuff. And we go about our lives like, you know, everything is just the way it is. You know, you're born, you grow up, you get to be an adult and work and do all the things people do, and that's that, right? Mm-mm. Wrong answer. And I know you say, what are you talking about and how can that be? Well, again, that's why tonight, as every other night, it's starting to sound like a Hebrew where they say, you know, with the Passover and stuff, that it's like every other Passover. it's not like every other night, but it's like every other Passover. Well, this is not like every other night. This is like every exegetical evening. And that's a good thing. now, I must bring up my boards and we'll prepare. as we always do. Anybody who's new, and I don't know how many people are watching, because lately I get a total of about six by the time it's all said and done, between doing this on StreamYard and being able to broadcast to YouTube and Twitter, which is kind of the, what would you call it, handover from Periscope to Twitter. People pop in out of nowhere and say, what is this guy teaching? And I'm telling you, it's Orthodox theology at its best. So it's not religion. And this board says it all. Grace are good news, but religion is not good news. And true or pure Christianity is not a religion. And if you think it is, then hear me out. See, the Bible was written in Greek and Hebrew for the Jews in the Old Testament, and then the New Testament, which is really for the Jews and the Gentiles, for the whole world. And in a way, because of that, since it's for the whole world, the good news for the whole world is we get both the Old Testament and the New. Today, I spent 2 hours, like I said, listening to Dan Wallace, and I hope to bring some of that to you. I made my own recording of it, but apparently another one may be coming my way. It was pretty cool to hear Dan teach on this stuff. And we're going to go ancient tonight, as a matter of fact, in that I can do this. Let me see if I want to – let me get rid of – actually, I can do it this way. I'm constantly learning this new program and having fun doing so. Let me see if I can put this up. How easy will this be? Okay, let me try this for a second. If I open this up and then I go back here, does this magically appear? Sure did. Where'd it go? Ha! Sorry about that, folks. I just saw what I wanted. It appeared and then it disappeared. Let me try this again. All right, now what? Oh, I think I know what's going on. Oh, man, that's kind of funny. No, maybe I don't know what's going on. I am trying to get you to see a particular thing, and I'm going to play it for you. A musical rendition, except it's not popping up. That is bizarre. Give me a second to figure this out. Oh, I figured it out. I just have to figure out how to get it to work so that I can do this now. Here we go. All right. I'm finally able to get the picture that I wanted up to you. And here it is with, you know what? I'm going to hold off on that for a second. I'm going to hold off because I want to finish the introduction and have us be in fellowship and all that good stuff before I pull that up. So I want to make sure that everybody knows the deal about this theological, exegetical, supernatural, biblical, supernatural stuff that we study. And the reason this board looks so weird with, I hope you can read it pretty well. It looks like it's mainly legible. We start out with a moment of silent prayer to prepare ourselves for the study of things that are over our head. I mean, they are really over our head. They are supernatural, spiritual over our head. And so the only way you're going to understand some of this, and you'll see why in a minute, is if you are in these two circles. Now, if you are a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, you were placed at the moment of faith in Christ into union with Christ and filled with the Holy Spirit. But after that, at some moment, whether it's a second later or 24 hours later, sometime soon after that, you get out of fellowship. What does that mean? You're no longer filled with the Holy Spirit. You're back in your previous original state or condition as a human being, where you are born with an old sin nature that is imputed to you at birth, at the moment of breathing, where God imputes to you Adam's original sin. For your sake, he does this. Because if you are born in sin, you have the opportunity to redeem your soul by faith alone in Christ alone. This is what the cross is all about. People right away tune out and say, oh, it's some Christian broadcast thing. No, this is a theological, exegetical broadcast that tries to explain the deep structure behind all of the stuff that we've already heard but don't understand. Does that make some sense? That's actually my job. My job is to present something that is otherwise pretty much incomprehensible to the world for various reasons. And I'm going to fix that problem, and I'll show you how we're going to do it. We are going to get involved tonight with all of these wonderful resources and facts. And then you will say, wow, I couldn't get that anywhere else tonight than on this broadcast. And I'm serious, you probably can't. I mean, I don't think anybody else is doing it. So the issue is being a believer who's in fellowship. That means that you are filled with the Holy Spirit instead of controlled by the old sin nature. We do that through a quick process of rebound. People often say, what the heck is all that? I say, well, you know, we've done three classes in Philemon and 153 classes on Monday nights in what I call exegesis introductions and basics of theology, which we do under the guise of reading these wonderful publications by R.B. Thieme Jr. Here's one of them that we do on Monday night right now. We're finishing up, and that's the kernel there in the cap. R.B. Thieme Jr. and R.B. Thieme Jr. Bible Ministries. Here's the catalog. If you want information on that, on YouTube, you can get it by simply going to, trying to hold this in a way that you can read what it says. There we go. R.B. Thieme Jr. Bible Ministries Doctrinal Studies Catalog. I'll move this over. Finally got it right. And on the back of that, here's the contact info. I was going to say you could go to Monday night's class, but guess what? You can get it right there. Let me blow that up and just for a second, so that you can see there's RB Theme, that's THIEME.org at the very bottom there. And the phone number, 713-621-3740. Call them and tell them, hey, I'd like that catalog, the Bible, Doctrinal Bible Studies catalog. And I'd like to get maybe the first book or two, like The Plan of God. And here's the second one called The Trinity. I call it the Triunity. And so I am hoping that these things, you will get them and read them and grow spiritually in a way that is otherwise impossible. And I'm hoping that you will benefit from this stuff in a way that will totally enrich your life. You know, I cannot tell you how much fun I'm having right now while all hell is breaking loose. I'm going to show you a couple pictures in a minute. But first, we're going to, knowing what I just said about this, if you're a believer, we're going to have a moment for silent prayer so that you can make sure you're filled with the Holy Spirit, that bottom circle. And also, if you have never believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, it says in Acts 16:31, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. And it's as easy as that, faith alone in Christ alone, and you become a believer. You are under what we call the blood of the cross, meaning you have been redeemed. Your sins are forgiven because they were paid for. Okay. All sins in the universe, you know, in the world, it's really in the world because it's all with people, dealing with people. So past, present, and future, they have been paid for at the time of the Lord's going to the cross and being judged for the sins of the world. Crazy piece of information that's actually true. So I am going to take a moment now, and we're going to pray and make sure that we're ready to be able to study these things and get something out of them. And I'm just going to show you stuff that is over our heads, and even a little bit over my head, maybe a lot over my head. I don't know. It depends on how you look at it. But the point is, we do get it, and we do learn enough, and we're going to see that tonight, and that one of the issues is dealing with the problems of, let's call it, people problems and relationships. It's going on in Philemon, but in a way, it's almost a done deal, let's say, that it ends up, according to what we can understand, it ends up great. And that's how we want our lives to be. We want them to end up great. We want things to work out. And so, without further ado, let's get ready to study these things, and we'll start by prayer. So let us pray. Once again, Heavenly Father, we thank you for your grace. We thank you that we can have fellowship with you, first by faith alone in Christ alone, and then secondly, thereafter, forevermore, by rebounding from any sins. And the three categories are mental attitude, sins of the tongue, and overt sins. In a general way, those are the three kinds that get committed. And in another way, they can be seen as two different categories. We either know we did it, known sin, or we can commit a sin that we didn't even know was a sin. And yet, when we come to you at this time like this and pray, you can forgive us of both, because the penalty for sin, which is death, was paid for on the cross when our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ went to the cross and bore the sins of the world. That made everything else that we do possible. The Lord Jesus Christ, fulfilled the scriptures and made it possible for us now to study them and understand them. So we thank you mucho, to use the Spanish word. We thank you so much for that reality. And I ask now that you would make that a reality to everyone who hears the words tonight, and that if there are any new believers, that they would be blessed and will be forevermore, both by the things that we study tonight and by everything that is contained in your plan for each person, so specifically for any new believers as well as for the rest of us. And we ask these all these things and thank you for them. B'Shem Yeshua HaMashiach, in Christ's name, amen. And voila, there we go again. We begin class in a way that, well, tonight I'm going to use music and scripture because I hold in my hands here the Biblia Hebraica Stuttgartensia, which is a fancy book. That above that in Hebrew, it says Torah, Nevi'im, V'Ketubim. Those are the three words written in Hebrew there. And we're going to turn to page, well, you can't, but anybody who has BHS, as we call it for short, on page 1209, right here, I have made a copy of this so I don't have to hold it up the whole time. And I'm going to put that up, and you are going to hear the first four verses sung by Michael Card. And then I'm going to make it possible for you to check out. This was a CD by Michael Card. And it says there, Haderek HaKakma. I guess I can point to the words. Let me hold it in some kind of way where I can do that. Let's see. Haderek HaKakma. Let's see if I can make that big. There you go. So you can actually see the Hebrew. And what does it mean? The way of wisdom. Derek means road or way. And Chakma The second word here, we read from right to left. The second word, so it's the way, the wisdom. In other words, that little kind of a, I don't know what shape to call that. We call it kind of like a house, you know, with a roof and two walls. And you see it there. That's the, in Hebrew, that's the definite article, the. So you have the Derek, the road, and the Kakma, the wisdom. And when you put them together like that, in a construct, as we call it. Gee, did I break the CD case or did it just split? I got to find the other half before I move and crunch it. Let me see. How did that disappear and go so far away? It's the clear part. I have this part, but I don't have the part that this goes in. Hold on a sec. Let me take a look. That's very interesting. There it is. Yeah, it broke. But that's okay. This little piece. I have spares. I'm in the business. So when that kind of nonsense happens, I just go find a spare. But the other thing I want to do is find the piece that broke off. Anyway, so this CD is wonderful, and this last piece, which is Psalm 121, is called My Help. There it is. And you see, it does have, yeah, they're so flimsy. That's funny. Let me put that up. Yep. And so anytime they drop, especially on a wood floor, you know, you've had it. but the CD is in the CD player. And this is an incredible collection. I think it's out of print. I think it was from 1991. And this particular piece, it's the end of the CD. Here's a backside. And he has, much like my CD, he's got the names of all the songs. And each song, you can see the way of wisdom. It'll say from Proverbs and Ecclesiastes under the sun and Job sweet. That one's incredible. Well, it's all great, but that one's really incredible. And now we're going to see number 10, My Help, Psalm 121. And you're going to hear Michael Carr singing in Hebrew. And so I've decided that I should, yeah, thank you for mentioning that. Let's put that up. The other thing I'm going to do is get the, let me see if I can pull up the Hebrew for you, which is unfortunately hard to read if you don't read Hebrew. But it has the, it says, Sir La Malot. And I think, let me see if I've got in the English here, it says, a song of ascents. That's what that little blurb means right up here. And I don't know if you can see my little marker. It's a little plus going right over that top part. And it calls that one, that's the super scripture. But one also starts in the second line. And remember, we're reading right to left. Man, I wish I could make a larger, like, what do you call those? A pointer. And so we are dealing with Psalm 121, and that it's going to be the four verses. That's all that I think. Let's see. Yeah, because we end with the word Israel, and that's on the bottom right there. Leonard, tell me if you can see my pointer, which is right now, instead of being a plus, it's an actual arrow. Can you see that at the last word there, Israel, where it says Yisrael? So it says Shomer Yisrael. That's the last time he sings it. I'm hoping, yeah, it's only verses 1 to 4 in the song. But anyway, I was wondering if, Leonard, if you can see my arrow. Oh, and there I make it big when I move it fast enough. Let's see. What do I have to do? Yeah.
I don't know if you can see that. Cannot see it. Okay, good. Well, now I know. That's was what it was before. So let's hear this song, and I will bring up the English when he sings it for the second half. So I'll have to do some tricky finger work here to get the screen happening. And one last thing is I have to find my remote, which I know is around here somewhere handy. There it is. Almost handy. Got to get around here to get to it. All right. So those of you who can't read Hebrew, it will be translated into English the second time around. So here we go. You're going to see this word, Esri.
Esri, may Adonai, Oseh Shamayim, Vares, El Yatin Lamotrag Leka, El Yanum Shomreka, I lift up my eyes to the hills, from whence shall come my help? My help is from the Lord God, maker of heaven and earth. He will not give to the moving of your foot, nor shall slumber he who keeps thee. Behold, he'll not slumber, nor will he sleep. He who keeps Israel.
In Hebrew, he said, Israel. And then he continued. So that was a cool way to do that. The first time, instead of resolving, you go to attention. And that's what we call tension release. So at the end, for instead of Israel, and you expect it to keep going. So at the end, it's Israel, which is the tonic, which is do, you know, do, re, mi. And the other one was re, or no, do, yeah, do. So it's do, re, mi, fa, sol, but it was Israel, Israel. Little musical information there, no extra charge. Part of my facts and music, blah, blah. All right, so anyway, you now have seen, oh, and I want to talk about this word that, well, let's see, I don't have to get it from the book. I can actually grab it right here again. Let me see. Can I put it? There we go. On this, let's see. At the end of the first long line, so what would be to us our left, because it goes right to left. You can see with the way the numbering is. One and then two. Well, that's verse one. And at the end there, there's this word, Esri. And at the beginning of the second line, you see the word Esri again. And I've been wanting to get to that for a while now. I originally had done, and let me stop that picture and see if I can add a new one. If I have it in the right place, I'll be able to pull it up. Oh no, I've got Arameneia instead of Esri. Well, I have it in my phone. So that's cool. I can pull it up off the phone. This, I brought this up to you recently Let me grab this particular screenshot that I have from the Word. It's the Word we're looking at. There we go. All right. Oh, and when did I take? I took the picture on May 12th. And today, yeah, so it was last week. Remember I showed you on the board this word. And remember we go right to left. So there's an ion and a zion and a resh. And reading it from left to right, it's instead of A-Z and the little A-R, Azar, it's in English, A-Z-A-R, left to right. And it means help. And I'm mentioning Psalm 121, 1 through 4. We wanted to know what is this business of help. And in the lyric, of course, coming from Psalm 121, from whence shall come my help? My help is from the Lord God, maker of heaven and earth. And then it goes on. All right. Well, I wanted to get into this because right now, the way things are, the way things are going in our country, we need to study the things that we're going to be studying tonight. They relate both from our passage in Philemon, where Paul is helping. What's he doing? He's helping Onesimus, and in a way, in a small way, he's helping Philemon. He's encouraging Philemon, but Onesimus, he had to really encourage. Say, well, yeah, Onesimus, certainly you could be executed if you go back. But, and here's where Paul's instinct kicks in. He says, trust me, I know Philemon. He won't execute you. He could execute you, but he won't. And I'm gonna tell him and remind him why he shouldn't. And it's all going to work out. So this idea in Psalm 121 is, where does my help come from? It comes from the Lord. These three people, Paul, and let's call it to Philemon, our text, of which we have spent 103 weeks. So we're into two full years. We're in the third year. Paul is encouraging Philemon, which in a way, in turn, is encouraging Onesimus. And one good turn deserves another. Onesimus is going to go back to Philemon and encourage Philemon, and Philemon encourage Onesimus. And that won't be the end of the story. That's one way to say it. Because things are going well. Okay. Oh, I got to take out this Psalm 121 because we're pretty much over that. Because we're now going to continue where we left off. And then after we do a little bit all over the Bible, because that's where our study is going to lead us, then, because that's what good exegesis does, we're going to continue with our exegesis manual that I have right here. Man, I've always got too many things all over the place. And we're going to see a little bit more about that. And then I have a feeling that on next Monday night, you're going to get to see a little bit of some good textual criticism by one of the best in the world, none other than the Dr. Dan Wallace. My professor, and I will even call him friend. And by the way, I'm going to be contacting him shortly. So you never know how that might turn into something interesting. So last week, we were working, and here's our theme a little bit, as per where we are in Philemon. And you know we've been working through Philemon verse, let's call it 21 and 22 verses, the two verses. Let me grab a couple of things here. Let me flip in my New American Standard over to verses 21 and 22. So the way The epistle is broken up. Verse 21 is a new paragraph, but basically 21 and 22 are their own paragraph, and then 23 and 24 and 25, those are the ending goodbye type verses. And greetings from our other guys that are here. They say hello and all that, okay? So what we would call conclusion, personal marks, and benediction. But starting at 21, it says, having confidence in your obedience, I write to you, Paul writes to Philemon, since I know that you will do even more than what I say. So he's encouraging Philemon and saying, I know you've got it going and you are going to do, you know, what needs to be done. Verse 22, and at the same time, also prepare me a lodging, for I hope that through your prayers, I shall be given to you, or you all, because it's plural, y'all. That is an interesting verse because there are two main ways to read that. One is that he's saying, oh, by the way, you know, yeah, I'm going to be coming, so hope to see you soon, that kind of comment. But a lot of the commentaries have a little bit more to say than that, saying things like, well, you know, by Paul putting that in the way he says it, he is almost saying, you better do what I say because I'm coming soon and I want to get there and see that it all worked out. That's kind of funny. I don't think Paul really did that, and I don't think he had that motivation. There's too much other good stuff going on here. But some people say that, and you can see how that would be what I call the psychological political sense, but not really. And it's absolutely not necessary. So pardon me, I'm going to chug a little bit of my good old Pellegrino with lime, and then review from last week and continue. So, cheers. All right. Last week, we started some notes on people problems on the job and how do you solve people problems on the job? Remember, this is Philemon and Onesimus, and that was a job. Ah, yes, I have the comment needs to come up. Cheers. And so on the job, you have Philemon as, let's call it, the boss, and Onesimus, the employee. But this carries on past the job. We have a chart. In fact, let me see if I'm able to get it up. Do I have this particular one handy? I guess not. You know, I'm telling you, there's so many pictures and charts. I will show you from last week. This is the one that I'm looking for. Let me close this and cancel that. All right, so where do I need to go? There you go. We saw this chart where virtue love resolves role model arrogance. And how? Well, motivational virtue is where you have personal love for God the Father. How do you get motivational virtue? Well, by having a positive volition toward Bible doctrine, you show up and you learn like we're doing tonight. We grow. And motivational virtue leads to this personal love for God the Father. It's my theta there for Theos, God, F, Father. Now, FV is functional virtue. So you have motivational virtue personal love for God. But then you start having functional virtue, which is impersonal love for all, meaning all mankind. What does impersonal mean? It's not personal. You just deal with all mankind. You always deal with them with integrity and virtue. That's why on the top, it's virtue love. So you have motivational virtue and functional virtue. So the first one, point one there, gives you personal love for God the Father. But the second one, which is functional virtue, gives you the ability to impersonally love everybody. Treat them all the same. Now, the point three there is the virtue love is occupation with Christ. At that point, when you really know Christ and you are motivated in so many ways by everything you know about him, that equals personal love for God the Son. So you see, by that point, you've got personal love for God the Father and personal love for God the Son. And of course, you'd say, well, if it weren't for the Holy Spirit, I would be out of fellowship. So now when it comes to that, all this virtue love resolves role model arrogance. We saw a little bit about the role model issue in business last week. And we saw that there were issues with sometimes we put somebody in a place and if they let us down, there comes an issue that we're going to see tonight called iconoclastic arrogance. And I'll write that down when we get to it. But it's where you make a role model out of someone or you make an idol out of them. And that's what icon, you know, we're dealing with icons, idols. And you make an idol of them and then, out pops the feet of clay syndrome, and you realize they're not all that. So you have built them up so high that now you got to throw tomatoes at them and, you know, break them down. So we're going to see, we read the first 9 or 10 points last week. I'm going to read the first, I'm going to read them real quickly. Here we go. Point one, there are three of virtue love. These are the content of impersonal love. There are three of virtue love which resolve the problems of role model arrogance. And the three things in virtue love, we just saw it on that chart, was motivational virtue, functional virtue, and occupation with Christ. Point two, personal love for God the Father provides the motivation for impersonal love to all mankind. And we saw that in 1 John 4. And this is why John wrote 1 John 4. Point three, the results in a grace orientation kind of way, followed by grace attitude toward all with whom you have contact. That is what this whole idea represents. It's that we, instead of treating people the way they deserve to be treated, we treat them with, you know, motivational virtue, functional virtue, and so on. Point four, occupation with Christ as a priority solution changes your mental attitude about yourself so that you change your mental attitude about people who aren't treating you the way you want to be treated, et cetera, right? You know, you disagree with, whatever. That's how we pray for our enemies, and so on. Point five, impersonal love is the result of personal love for God the Father and occupation with Christ. So that impersonal love that we saw on the picture is kind of the big deal here. It's point two there. Functional virtue equals impersonal love for all mankind, and that's, if you go from that point two down to the bottom, it resolves role model arrogance. So that is, you know, the result that we want. Point six, it is the result of the teaching ministry of God, the Holy Spirit, as you are exposed to Bible doctrine. all of that Bible doctrine, which is why I was saying we want to have access to books like this through the ministry, this doctrinal Bible studies catalog from RB Theme Junior Bible Ministries. And again, there's that phone number. You can call them tomorrow, and or you can go to the website and get a lot of stuff. And everything is available without charge or obligation. And like he used to say, this is grace. All right. So again, the result, point six, is through this teaching ministry of God, the Holy Spirit, as you're exposed to Bible doctrine, you are able to do the right things, the biblical thing. And you have to have the power to do it, which is why I said you have to be filled with the Spirit. Point seven, impersonal love provides the solution to unrealistic expectation and role model syndrome. So the adult believer, meaning a mature believer, can pass people, system, and thought testing in both providential preventative suffering and thought testing. Those are technical terms that you learn in these books. Like we write PPS, providential preventative suffering, and thought testing. I just put THOT/test, thought test. Point eight, impersonal love toward all gives the spiritual adult the ability to overcome any form of hurt, frustration, anger, bitterness, implacability, and hatred toward any others who have failed as a role model, i.e. the boss, you know, somebody like that. And so in all caps, I say, so wait on the Lord and use the divine solutions. What are those divine solutions? Well, we learn them as we go here, and you should learn them. They're in the scriptures, and you learn them in books that you read about the Bible and that people have written, or in church or whatever. But you don't learn it by going to church once a week on Sunday. And, you know, they sing and somebody talks for a while, and then you greet other people and shake hands, and then you go to lunch. Guess what? That is a thimble full of Bible doctrine. You will not be able to function throughout the week on just a minimal amount. It's kind of like nutrition. You know, you're not going to be healthy by having a minimal amount of food. You have to have a balanced, and just like we have to eat every day, like it says, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth from the or out of the mouth of God, which is the word of God, the Bible, and that's Matthew 4:4. All right, so then we continued point nine. The greater the preoccupation with self, the greater the expectation of others. And that's going to get you into trouble. And then I think we finished with point 10. The greater your romantic notions, the more you expect from others, i.e. of the opposite sex. And notice I didn't say of the same sex. That's on purpose. It's biblical. Anybody who wants to check the notes, go to especially Romans chapter 1. And even in the area around verse 26, 27, whatever. But Romans chapter 1 gets into the details of that. So again, point 10, the greater your romantic notions, the more you expect from others of the opposite sex, in this case, dealing with romance, in both romance and marriage. Now, I don't think I got this far. I think this is where we're continuing on now is principle point 11. The higher the standards, the more unrealistic the expectation, i.e., in other words, the greater the perfection you assign to that role model, you know, what is it? The farther you fall, you know, the higher you go, the farther you got to fall. So that's the principle there. Point 12, it is a fact of life. Most people are assuming. And remember that word, how you spell it? A-S-S-U and then M-E. So ass, you, and me. It's a fact of life most people are assuming. And so we get that idea, make an ass out of you and me. Point 13. Also, it is a fact of life most people are disappointed with or in the role models they have assigned in their own thinking. So again, point 13, it's also a fact of life that most people are disappointed with or in the role models they have assigned in their own thinking and in their own experience, in their life, you know, in their day, who they're with, and so on. I notice that about every relationship. It just seems that there's always a, once you get to know somebody well enough, there's the up and the downsides. Point 14, when the feet of clay are discovered, the image is smashed. Point 15, it never occurs to people that the role model assignment never can be fulfilled. And I'll repeat this. And they always point the finger at the role model. All right, so again, point 15. It never occurs to people that the role model assignment never can be fulfilled, and they always point the finger at the role model. Point 16, the only role model mandated in the Christ-centered life or Christian way of life is the Lord Jesus Christ, and he is the only celebrity. And remember, there was a book. Is it still available? Let me check. I'm looking to see if the celebrity ship, I should show it to you. The celebrity ship of Jesus Christ. That's another old one. When did I get that one? 1982. Used to be called Baraka Tapes and Publications in Houston, Texas. And it eventually became RB Theme Junior Bible Ministries. And this particular book was written in 1973. And it's a great study on why Jesus Christ is the unique person of the universe. And in a way, his celebrity ship, he's really the only celebrity. And let me see here. I know the last thing I wanted to do is check in the publications here. Is the celebrity ship of Christ still available? See, there must have been about 100 books, and some of them have been absorbed by some of the newer books. In other words, whatever doctrine and data was in that book and the subject or subjects, it's handled in these other books, and so they discontinued some of the earlier books, and they probably had other reasons as well to edit them out. And say, well, the data, the doctrine is covered in these other texts. And so they just eliminate ones that they can eliminate. And that one seems to be one of the ones that is no longer in print. But the doctrines are still available. By the way, I will show you the table of contents. That way you can see a little bit what it's about. Check this out. Very interesting stuff. Yeah, Leonard says, that's an old one. Yeah, we're getting close to 50 years, 1973. See down here by my finger, 1973, RB Theme, Junior All Rights Reserved, blah, blah, blah. Now, here's the contents. Check out these thoughts. The objective of the Christian life grace thinking, the mental attitude of Christ, the pre-incarnate Christ, doctrine of the deity of Christ, occupation with Christ, the incarnate Christ, the doctrine of kenosis. That's Philippians 2:7, by the way, where he emptied himself. That's what kenao means, to empty. The sustaining ministry of the Holy Spirit to the humanity of Christ. The humiliation of Christ in relation to kenosis. Yeah, his emptying. The doctrine of the hypostatic union. It's very interesting. He had to become a man, and yet he had to stay God. So hypostatic, there's two unions and two things together. One of them is God and one of them is man. And you're like, how can they coexist? Well, in the study, as you learn about the hypostatic union, you're able to then understand how that works. The doctrine of impeccability, the uniqueness of Christ's humility, the uniqueness of his death, the exalted Christ, the doctrine of ascension, and the recognition of the celebrityship of Christ. And then there's appendix, the doctrine of mental attitude and a glossary of terms. So these were well-written books, but the doctrines contained therein are now available in other texts. And see, look, he still had, you know, the footnotes set up and everything and tell you to go to, you know, different books like Canonicity or Super Grace Life. I think Super Grace Life is out of print, but Canonicity is not. So, by the way, I have some books that I didn't have, some of these other books. I didn't have the book, but they had them in the library when I was in seminary in Portland, Oregon at Western Seminary. And I, in the library, when I saw all those books, I literally took each book and went to the copier and photocopied every book page by page. And so I have that. Let me see if I can, well, I'll do it another time. So not to interrupt where we are now, because we've got to get through a couple more points and then we'll continue again next week in this section. So point 16, the only role model mandated in the Christian way of life or Christ-centered life is the Lord Jesus Christ. Don't make a role model out of husbands, wives, and bosses, because you'll get yourself in all kinds of trouble and you'll see their feet of clay and then you'll want to destroy them. Throw tomatoes. All right, point 17. So the believer must must have or must take responsibility for his own bitterness, his own implacability, etc., etc., when he smashes the icon. So you're always responsible for the fact that, and that's why we call it iconoclastic arrogance, you blew it, you made a role model out of a person, and they can't be a role model, they aren't perfect, they're gonna, quote, you know, let you down or fail you in some way or ways. And, you know, you shouldn't set yourself up for the fall. So that was point 17. I'll repeat it. So the believer must have or must take responsibility for his own bitterness, implacability, etc., etc., all these, you know, those are mental attitude sins, when he smashes the icon, the role model. Point 18, the solution is not found in reaction to people who do not treat you the way you want to be treated or loved. You know, they don't love you the way you want to be loved. The solution is in applying the scriptures. Okay, but you got to learn the scriptures. And you got to learn them isagogically, categorically, and exegetically. And that's what I propose you continue to do if you've been doing it all along. And if you haven't been doing it, that's the way to do it. Point 19, the solution is not found in the arrogance complex or where any of the emotional sins are. You know, the solutions, again, are in perception, metabolization, and application of Bible doctrine. All right, so principle point 20, here's another principle. You can't expect to change people. Ha, where have you heard that before? You don't have to be a Christian or read the Bible or get it from there. You can't expect to change people. Point 21, but you can solve the problems related to the frustrations that come from interaction with others. And how do you do that? Only through the use of virtue love as a problem-solving device. So again, we have virtue love. And this is why it's so important. Through motivational virtue, functional virtue, and occupation with Christ, you're able to resolve role model arrogance. I don't know any other easier way to put it than that. So, I want to, we'll do this. We will eventually get thick into this. Let's call it next week. Turn with me to Galatians 5:14. And we will, from that verse, go through Leviticus, Matthew, Mark, Romans, Galatians, and even John 15, 1 John 3, 1 John 4, Ephesians, and 1 John 3, another verse, before we get through breaking down what it says in Galatians 5:14, which talks about, let me read it, says, for the whole law is fulfilled in one word, in the statement, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. And that is what we're going to study in some detail, the agapao plesion seautu, love your neighbor as yourself, and how that is possible, how it is done. Okay, so I will stop here now so that we can continue with principles and practice of Greek exegesis, this manual, and that way we can continue to see how by doing exegetical biblical study, the exegetical method of studying the Bible, we're able to come up with the orthodox reading. And Dan Wallace did a very interesting job today in explaining, and he did it from Romans 5:1 with that one word where it said ekomen, and it was either with an omicron or an omega. And the omega made it a subjunctive, which completely changes the idea. In fact, I'll read Romans 5:1 and give you the idea. Now, remember when I say I'll read Romans 5:1, I'm actually going to be giving you two renderings of Romans 5:1. And one rendering is, therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord. We have peace. Ekomen. Is it we have peace, or with the omega, the subjunctive mood, and it's what we call a hortatory subjunctive, where you make it a we or an us, a weems or an usums, funny way to say it that Dan was saying, where we would say, therefore, having been justified by faith, let us have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. So is it let us have peace? and we don't have it? Or is it we have peace, which is a present indicative mood, so a present active indicative, it's indicative, it's a dogmatic declaration or statement of fact. The other way, it's almost that third class condition. Maybe we have it, maybe we don't, but it's not exactly like that. It's not the construction of like when we have the word if we confess our sins, if we name, cite, claim, admit, or acknowledge our sins, and we would make that if a maybe we will, maybe we won't. Here it would say, let us. See how that's even a different category than maybe we will, maybe we won't. Let us, we call that a hortatory with a imploring. And we're getting this kind of stuff lately. So you're starting to get used to these kinds of ideas. This is where the rubber meets the road when it comes to exegesis. So when it says, therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, I have a note in this Scofield Study Bible, and it says, some ancient manuscripts read, let us have. See, so therefore, having been justified by faith, let us have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. So even in this Study Bible, there is a footnote that shows that. Let me put this down and show it to you in this way. And, you know, I was in a semester class where we did the entire book of Romans. It's fifth semester Greek. So you're doing some serious exegesis in your fifth semester of Greek in graduate school. There is... let me see if I can get it over. Verse 5, and it says, therefore, having been justified by faith, that little diamond, we have peace. Well, if you go over to the footnote over on the in here, and you go to 5:1, let me see if I can stretch that out so you can see it. Some ancient manuscripts, MSS, read, let us have. There it is. So today, Dr. Wallace, who has written many fine things, and right here I'm going to show you two of them. Let me see if I can do this well. Hang on. I want to make sure I don't have a disaster with all the books falling over. Here are two of Dan's books. One is called, let me see, am I getting that right? The Basics of New Testament Syntax and Intermediate Greek Grammar. And then this one, which is the thicker, I should show you that these two are about the same, but look at the thicknesses. The Greek Grammar Beyond the Basics, an exegetical syntax of the New Testament. And I don't think they show any pictures of Dr. Dan in these books, do they? I always wonder when people have their picture in the book and other times they don't. But anyway, Dan is one of the premier textual critics alive today, as far as a lot of people are concerned. We consider him one of the finer, not just an exegete, but a textual critic. And that's why I say he explained things. It was very fun to hear his understanding of Greek is as good or better than my understanding of music. And in other words, I have a music learning teaching system, and it's federally registered as such. And so the name of it is Facts of Music. And the reason was I didn't want it to be theory of music or music theory. I said, yes, theory is theory, but a lot of what people are calling music theory, because they don't know what they're talking about, it's really basic harmony, you know, facts. facts about music. And so I said, you know, facts of music. And then I thought, hey, I could use that name. And there it is. Facts of music. And so that little R next to the music there on top, that means it's federally registered. And there's the logo, the little eighth notes. And so facts of music was in contrast to theory of music. And theologically speaking, doing this kind of work, like textual criticism, higher criticism, which has to do not with criticizing anything, but with the critical work, you know, digging deep. And we're going to see that tonight. I'm going to start on page 11, and I think I can go, and timing is such, yeah, to page 13. We're going to make it through this section B called the Grammatical, Historical, Contextual Method of Interpretation. So remember when people say, oh, no, the Bible doesn't say that. Well, you got to talk to exegetes and textual critics to find out what it really says. And here's why. Because when you get to this section right here, it says, look at this. Here's a way to do it. Grammatical, historical, contextual method of interpretation. So we need a definition. What is that? This approach seeks the meaning of a segment of Scripture as required by the laws of grammar and literary form, the facts of history, you know, as we were talking about facts and music, and the framework of context. It is the best approach because these are the features the interpreter must share with the author in order to determine his meaning, the author's meaning. And I could put his or another in parentheses, his with a capital H. So what is the best approach? The grammatical, historical, contextual with the required laws of grammar and literary form and the facts of history and the framework of context. That's where the rubber meets the road. And this is the beginning of getting into the details that make the difference between having a correct interpretation or an erroneous or flawed, a fallacious, you know, a fallacy. It's not the correct interpretation. So we start with one, we said the definition of grammatical, historical, contextual interpretation. Two, evangelical presuppositions underlying grammatical, historical, contextual interpretation. And under that, we have four parts, A, B, C, and D. And under C, we have three subpoints. So let's take a look at this, okay? Major point two, evangelical presuppositions underlying grammatical, historical, and contextual interpretation. A, the evangelical exegete holds to the verbal inspiration and inerrancy of the Old and New Testaments. That's 2 Timothy 3, 14 through 17. I want to read that because you actually see that Paul is telling Timothy, and Timothy and Titus are what we call pastoral epistles. And so they're very much involved in helping us understand what a pastor should do, what he must be like. Maybe you could say what he shouldn't do and what he shouldn't be like and all that. So in 2 Timothy 3:17, well, let me go 14 through 17. But 17 is the bottom line in exegesis. Okay, here we go. Paul says to Timothy, you, however, continue in the things you have learned and become convinced of, knowing from whom you have learned them, verse 15, and that from childhood, Timothy, you have known the sacred writings which are able to give you the wisdom that leads to salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. See, Timothy's mother and grandmother raised him, and they were believers. Verse 16, this is a great one, 2 Timothy 3:16. All scripture, and let me read it to you this way. I'm trying to think of the, because I'm getting confused now because I'm looking at a New American Standard. All scripture is God-breathed and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction in righteousness, that the, all scripture is God-breathed and is profitable for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God might be mature, thoroughly approved, to rightly divide the word of truth, something like that. All right, here's what it says here. All scripture is inspired, and that's the word theopneustos, where I said God breathed. All scripture is inspired by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and the word there is nouthetasis, for training in righteousness, in integrity. Here we go, verse 17, that the man of God may be capable or adequate, or in other words, prepared, equipped for every good work. Now, Bob Thiem used to read it. All scripture is God-breathed and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God might be thoroughly prepared. Now, I always, when I keep going, I space it out. Like it says, adequately equipped for every good work. And he might have said for every good deed, which would be the King James Version. You know what? Just for fun, that's verse 17, but 16 and 17. I'm going to grab a King James Version. Where is my... Aha, it's already out. Let me see where it is. Where is the, here it is. Haha, always trying to find all these books. They're piled all around. All right, let's look at 2 Timothy. There's first. I just want to see the actual translation. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. And Bob had translated that perfect into approved, that the man of God may be approved or might be approved, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. So it's very close to the King James Version. Let me see if I can show you that right there, verses 16 and 17. All scripture is given. Now, I say the way Bob used to say it, all scripture, let's see, the word of God is alive and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of the soul and the spirit and the joints and the marrow, and is a critic of thoughts and intents of the heart. That's Hebrews 4:12. All scripture. See, now I can't do it because I'm looking at the King James Version. How did he say it again? All scripture is God-breathed and profitable for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God might be thoroughly, might be mature, thoroughly approved unto God, and to, what does it say here? Equipped or adequate to do all good works, for all good works. So thoroughly furnished unto all good works. Yeah, I'm doing now combinations between the New American Standard, the corrected translation that Bob Thiem would read, his corrected translation, which is done through exegesis, and the original King James Version. So you can see it's a good way to get yourself a little bit tongue twisted and confused between those three versions. Now, continuing, I'm going to read again for under 2A. So 2, evangelical presuppositions underlying grammatical, historical, contextual interpretation. A, the evangelical exegete holds to the verbal inspiration and inerrancy of the Old and New Testaments, 2 Timothy 3, 14 through 17, as we've just been messing with.
In these supernaturally inspired documents, definitive propositional truth is given to man by a personal God. B, the evangelical exegete maintains that there is genuine history containing factual substance that, so history and facts, that can be studied from an objective viewpoint. This involves a true subject-object distinction, namely man, the subject, understanding and applying God's truth revealed in written revelation, the object, okay, the scripture. So illuminated by God, the scripture illuminated. C, the evangelical exegete sees scripture as literature written for a purpose. This involves several facts. This is where I told you there's going to be 3 points. One, the meaning of a segment of scripture is the meaning intended by the author, capital A, / author, little a. Number two, the literary medium chosen by the author, capital A, / author, little a, is the best one to communicate the purpose of a passage. And three, the particulars of a passage truly subserve the purpose of the whole. Wow, that's a bunch of stuff. That's these 3 facts. Evangelical exegete sees scripture as literature written for a purpose involving the meaning of a segment of scripture is the meaning intended by the author. The literary medium chosen by the author is the best one to communicate the purpose of a passage. And three, the particulars of a passage truly subserve the purpose of the whole. Now, finally, section D, the evangelical exegete depends upon the illuminating and teaching ministry of the Holy Spirit by means of prayer, meditation, and diligent study. So think about it. If I am doing my job to exegete, I am thinking prayerfully and in meditation and with diligent study, I'm thinking about whatever the subject is, the passage, and who is the subject or what the subject is, and then what is the goal or the object or who is the object involved. Okay, now, major point 3 of the 4 points. So definition of grammatical, historical, contextual interpretation. Evangelical presuppositions underlying grammatical, historical, contextual interpretation. The evangelical exegetes see scripture as literature written for a purpose involving the facts that we noted. And now, the final one, the evangelical exegete depends upon the illuminating and teaching ministry of the Holy Spirit by means of prayer, meditation, and diligent study. Now, section 3. Basic guidelines of grammatical, historical, contextual interpretation. Before I get into it, notice that when we're doing Philemon, we have the grammar, which is always looking at the words in the text. We do that. And then historical, we look at what was going on. When was it written? Who wrote it to whom? Where was the writer? Where was the recipient? You know, how's all that connected? So there you have the historical and contextual interpretation. So the context, we have a runaway slave and a master, or let's call it the boss at the job. What is he like? What is the runaway employee thief like? In other words, a slave who stole from the master. We have Paul, who is actively involved in both their lives. Who is he? What's his function? And how does all this tie together? So in this section 3, we're going to have 8 parts, A through G.
Section 3, basic guidelines of grammatical, historical, contextual interpretation. A, the priority of the original languages. And in this case, New Testament, we're in Greek. B, the principle of the plain meaning, the meaning the author intended, which is shareable with his readers. C, the principle of grammatical interpretation, observing the shared conventions of grammar. When I say shared conventions, we're having to deal with English grammar and Greek grammar because we're reading Greek and translating it and having to somehow, we can use the word marry, you know, to marry the two. You can sort of use the word blend, to blend the two together. But there's another word, and it's escaping my mind right now. Oh, yeah. It's a musical word, but it's a Greek word, harmonia. To harmonize the two. There, that's a big issue, a big term in theology. We are going to harmonize the Greek with the English. And that's a skill, and it takes work. And at the end, you have a, through this process and procedure, you have a result. You have a translation. Okay, so there's an interpretation, and that becomes your translation. So, D, the principle of historical interpretation, observing the known circumstances of history, geography, and culture. By the way, we're trying to change all that, aren't we, in America? 1776, 1619. You know, 15, whatever it was, you know, with the original, what's it called? Thanksgiving, we had the, what are they called again? The Pilgrims. Knew it was a P word. It wasn't coming to me. The Pilgrims. So we're in the process, 1920 of changing things. Yeah, there's a comment. 1920, we decide that it's going to go this direction. And so what do? We're going to have progressivism. 1920 took 100 years to get to where we are today. It's been a long march, in the words of and writings of Antonio Gramsci. So continuing, that was D, the principle of historical interpretation, observing the known circumstances of history, geography, and culture. E, the principle of contextual interpretation, observing the linkage between the text and its context, both immediate and broad. This is a part of exegesis that's important. F, the principle of the clearest interpretation, determining whether our conception of the meaning causes the particulars of the text to make sense. Let me repeat that because it's a bit thick. The principle of the clearest interpretation, determining whether our conception of the meaning causes the particulars of the text to make sense. That has to happen. That needs to be the result. And we have to work that through. As Dan Wallace often says, I heard him say it a couple times today, we have to wrestle with it. His son was a wrestler. I'm not sure if he was a wrestler, but definitely he is a wrestler of meaning of the text. And then finally, we have point G, or the eighth point here, the principle of the analogy of faith. And for that, while recognizing the fact of progress in revelation, there is such a thing as progressive revelation, and it is a part of our exegesis, our understanding of a given passage should be consistent with the known data of divine revelation as a whole. So again, that word to harmonize things. They have to go together. So again, G, the principle of the analogy of faith, while recognizing the fact of progress in revelation, our understanding of a given passage
should be consistent with the known data of divine revelation as a whole. Finally, section four, and its three subpoints, limitations of grammatical, historical, contextual interpretation. Here are three of them. A, the goal of exegesis, the intended meaning, can become lost in an uncharted mass of technical detail. That is a problem in the world today. Cheers. Lots of technical detail. B, the unity of the Word of God may be ignored by too narrow a perspective on a passage. So you can mess up, let's call it Bible doctrine. The unity of the Word of God may be ignored, the unity, okay, by too narrow a perspective on a passage. And that messes up your understanding and your, so your perception is messed up, your application, I should say the metabolization is going to be messed up, and then your application gets messed up. And finally, C, the principles of the approach can become straitjackets rather than guidelines for the exegete. So there has to be a certain amount of looseness of, you know, all right, I need to get, you know, perspective and balance. And that can sometimes take time. And in fact, some of the discussion today, the whatever you want to call it, seminar of sorts, included that issue, that it sometimes is hard to know an answer. So you propose an answer and it's still kind of fluid. It's not fixed. It's like Jell-O that hasn't hardened yet. It's still liquidy. And so it says again, C, the principles of the approach can become straitjackets rather than guidelines for the exegete. You do need that's a limitation. You need to go with the flow. Now, next time, which may be on Monday, I think, we will start at major point six, an approach to the discipline of exegesis. And trying to see. Yeah, that may have to be broken into two parts, because it's pretty detailed and long. Well, I'll see if I can get through it, depending on how long our passage is. In our other text, our Monday night text, Mental Attitude Dynamics, which we are getting close to finishing. When I say finishing the text, then there are some addenda, there are a couple of appendices, and we want to see those because they will help us in our understanding of mental attitude dynamics that we've been working on so consistently. So tonight, again, we continued in this understanding of Philemon dealing with people problems and how virtue love is the mechanics. It's when you learn about virtue love, you learn how to deal with people problems. And so we see toward the end of Philemon, Paul is saying, hey, Philemon, I know you got this one. You're going to do well. And, you know, you just have to apply what you know. So as we continue next Wednesday night, we're going to be all over the Bible, because remember, we got started there with, what did I do with my notes? I buried them already. Where are they? That's so funny. Again, I told you I have so many books and piles here. What did I do with that notebook? Is it underneath all this? Ah, there it is. Yeah, we're going to continue where we started tonight about love your neighbor as yourself in Galatians 5:14. And we're going to see that neighbor means anyone in your periphery or vicinity, not the next door neighbor. That's an important thing that with everything I just read to you about exegesis, you look at this word plaseon and you say, oh yeah, that's translated neighbor. Well, okay, so what does that mean? No, it does not mean your next door neighbor. It includes your next door neighbor, but the concept in plaseon is broader than that. And so what we're talking about here in these elements of exegesis and tonight, the grammatical, there it is, a word. And then the context. So you've got a grammatical, historical, contextual method of interpretation. That's what goes into you having an English Bible. And that's a great thing. I mean, without an English Bible, you know, you'd have to have somebody like myself grab all these ancient manuscripts. And that's, by the way, that's why I say textual critic. Dan Wallace, being a textual critic, he has special cameras. That was one of the things he showed at the beginning about how they use special cameras to be able to see deeper, almost like a microscope onto the paper, and be able to see. I hopefully will play some of that for you next. I guess it would be on Wednesday. I don't think it will be on Monday. We'll have to see because I haven't decided yet. But I do want you to see some of that because it goes a long way, as does my video. And I'm trying to remember if the video is handy here, is nearby. I don't see it. But there is a video that Dan Wallace is in and on or whatever. A DVD. I have a Blu-ray version of it, and our very own Leonard has now a DVD version of it, and I'm looking for it, but I don't see it. Where is that DVD hiding? I want to show it to you if I can, but I can't see it. All right, well, I'll have to skip that for now. I don't see it quickly. Where did that guy go? Hold on a sec. Let me just double check. I had it all the way back over with the other DVDs and stuff, so, but at least I found it. Fragments of Truth. Can we trust the Bible? This used to be in Blu-ray only. And now, if you want to get a copy of it, you can go to Amazon and find it. And look, there's also fragmentsoftruth.com. And it's very cool that Dan Wallace participated in this work. And again, here you see the scripture. It's on the actual Blu-ray or DVD. And that's the cover there. And that's a little bit what it looked like today, some of the stuff. But then with that special camera, you wouldn't believe what they can do. And where parts are missing, like that black section there where it's just ripped out, they do certain things to show what it could say based on the rest of the letter. They take a particular alphabet letter and put it in there, and you start to see where it could read this way or that way. And they don't mess around with that. I mean, they're very serious, so they do an orthodox, you know, correct, whatever you want to call it, rendering, and they do it, very seriously and correctly. So they don't mess with it. But, man, there are things that you can do, just like with all the rest of our technology,
the level of software and computers, and in this case, cameras, and they're digital, and they're very expensive, fancy schmancy cameras. So he will be going to, I forget if he said it's in Europe, in where did he said they had, did he say they had it? A particular manuscript is now in one of the countries in Europe, and they're going to go there and then get the picture of it using that camera. So that's the kind of stuff that he does as a textual critic and a professor at Dallas Seminary. And he is largely responsible. I think he was the senior editor of the New Testament part of the NET Bible. And it makes sense that he would be, because he's such a great, yeah, he is a really serious theologian, you know, PhD. I guess he doesn't have his THD, but even a PhD is a lot of work, right? I don't know if you know this, but a THD is a lot more work. So one is a doctor of philosophy, PhD. The other one is a doctor of theology, THD. And that one takes about 10 years. So that's probably all we have for tonight. I guess I could go to my other, my picks and notes. I wanted to mention to you that, as I mentioned on Monday night, I went to a meeting, and I think I can show you this picture. Let me get this one up. I may have mentioned to you that I was with the ex-Arizona Attorney General, and he spoke at length. He was the speaker. Let's see. Okay, that would be the person right there at the podium. And I don't think I can blow this up. I'm not sure how that works. I don't think it makes it any bigger. But he's right there at the podium. And that is Tom Horn. And this other guy here with the coat and tie on the right side of the picture, that is a guy named Michael, what was his last name? Shoot, I'm spacing out now on his last name. But we had some extra time together afterwards, and it was a very interesting situation to see these guys. Let me see if I can get another couple pictures. I wanted you to see this because it's kind of funny. In Arizona, you had these two guys. I'm not sure if they're brothers, but they were singing. And I think it's funny to see this picture where you see Arizona is an open carry state. So people have their, you know, 9mm, 45s, 38s, whatever the heck they have. And meanwhile, they're just singing a song together. that's at that same podium there. And that's just the way it is in Arizona, you know. Nobody cares if you're carrying firearms. It's the old West, and they're obviously going to have no problem with that. Let me see if I have any other picks that I want to share. Oh, yes, I do. At that very moment, Saturday from 11 to 1, that was going on, in downtown Phoenix, there was another thing going on. And I went to, on TV, I saw it afterwards on RSBN. And you see in this picture, Freedom May 15th, 5:15 in Phoenix on RSBN. And there's a We the People Are Pissed Off, it says. But what it was is it was not Democrat or Republican. It was just a bunch of people, I guess you'd say mostly conservatives, in the downtown Phoenix area. And they were all there to share their concerns
and their desire for our country to, you know, to continue in the way that it was originally envisioned. And so there were only about 200 people at that thing, but I got to see a part of it on RSBN. And again, I like to let you all know that, you know, there are stations out there that we can watch that have other bits and pieces of news and information that we're not seeing in the regular, let's call it, what's the right word for the traditional media? There's another word for that. But anyway, you know, all the stations that everybody always knew. These are new ones like RSBN, NTD, Newsmax, and they definitely show things that are going on that are not being seen or shared in, you know, the other mainstream. That's the word I was looking for, the mainstream media. So I'm checking right now. I see on Twitter that a couple of people retweeted one of my tweets about what's going on in Arizona now with this audit as it's proceeding. And so I think a bunch of, you know, things are happening there that you will, within a week or two, you'll be hearing a lot more in every media, because it's finally, things are coming out and they're beginning to come to a head. So you will be seeing more about that soon and hearing all about it. And I'll be letting you know anything more that I find out as I hear as well. So on that note, we've covered a bunch tonight. And as it said here, we would continue with the exegesis manual. And we didn't get all over the Bible yet in our Philemon passage. I stopped right at that point because it does start taking us everywhere. So we will go there. We will continue this next Wednesday night. And on Monday, we will continue in our text, Mental Attitude Dynamics. And we will continue on page 40 with, check this out, The Ascendancy of David. Let me see if I can get that front and center. And so it's going to be really interesting. Speaking of mental attitude dynamics, you're going to need to know how David thought and how he acted. So any thoughts or questions? If not, if you don't have anything to add, remember that we always go to this prayer board, and I get stuck on how close I can go based on how many books are on the table here. When they're too high, then you can't see the top of the board, and the bottom gets covered by the corner there, 0.7 there about students. But you remember that prayer doesn't count unless you pray the way God says in the scriptures how to pray. And the first thing is rebound, and after that, thanksgiving, and then intercession, not praying for what you think you need, but rather thinking about others and praying for them and their needs. So on that note, whenever you have any thoughts, thank you, Leonard. I see just now that you made a comment. You know, the whole point of doing these broadcasts is to try to get together and learn what the scriptures say, and then in a quote, having fellowship together, you know, fellowship in quotes, we're able to do things to further the plan of God and to grow spiritually. And this is a big part of it. Prayer is huge. It's our special privilege to be able to have a two-way conversation with God. You know, not just God to us, but us to God. And that means it can go back then from us to God. He responds. And people think, oh, no, you can't do that anymore. You know, God spoke to Moses, and
and he spoke to a couple of the Lord, spoke to obviously to David, and spoke to the Lord, the Father, to the Lord. When they obviously see the Lord prayed, and he asked the Father to do certain things. So you know there was a two-way conversation going there. And so no matter what the circumstances are, we need to be able to go to God and pray about it. And this prayer board gives you the order. There's four things: rebound, thanksgiving, intercession, and petition. And again, that's one of the books that I recommend. The one main book in particular. There's a second one too. The first one that is really book 12 in the basics books is just simply called Prayer. But the other one, I think it's still available, The Power of Prevailing Prayer. I hope that one's still available. I'm looking too soon. I don't know if it is. But anyway, if you just get the prayer book, that's enough to get you to see everything that I just said as far as the four parts of prayer. And so, and it's now, I guess, time to call it a night and close in prayer. So on that note, without any further ado, let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are always grateful for another opportunity to spend time focusing on you, not by ourselves, but corporately. And even if there's only two or three people or six, it's a couple of replay people or whatever, the main thing is that the things that we talk about here, if they are the things you want us to talk about and want us to be thinking about, then we know that that glorifies you. And we know that as we are talking about these things and reading them, we are learning things, we are solidifying things that we know. And it's all great. It's all the real deal, the stuff that we really need to be doing, the real reason that we're here, and that ultimately edifies us and glorifies you. And we thank you for all these things. We ask them as always, B'Shem Yeshua HaMashiach, in Christ's name, amen. And so on that note, a good night and a wish that you have a good rest of the week and weekend. And hope to see you on Monday. And who knows, maybe now afterwards I can call Leonard and catch up. And indeed, amen and amen. And so thanks, Leonard. And you guys have a good night. And hopefully maybe catch up with you on the weekend. And otherwise, stay well and keep on glorifying God and growing in grace and having a great time. And so we will see you on the next one. And with that, I bid you good night. All right, good night. Oh, yeah, you're getting to bed. All right, goodbye. Talk to you soon. Bye.